171. Country tis of thee. 571.
Blessed opportunity to meet together in this place. Lord, we thank you for the Lord Jesus Christ who came and died on our behalf that we might have eternal life in him. Lord, we pray for those that are visiting. We pray for those that are ill. We pray for our country in the transition that is coming. We know that you are in control. Yes. And no matter who the president is, Jesus is still King of Kings.
Amen.
And we thank you for that. And we praise you. Bless the service in its entirety. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
All right, continuing the song, just across to the other side, 572, America.
Thank you.
couple of pages. And it's as Pastor said, I mean, we have all these elections, God lifts up and puts down our leaders, but honestly, our God reigns. God is on the throne. Number 229.
Talked about the Colosseum, we talked about all the horrible things that happened during the time of the Roman Empire. But you know, our brothers and sisters were trusting in the Lord, just like we need to trust in the Lord. And we have so much more. We have the Word of God. We have the Word of God preached.
Amen.
And we have a wonderful and merciful Savior.
rendition. Beautiful hymn. We're celebrating Veterans Day, which is coming up Wednesday. And this being the service that the majority want to honor our veterans. We have several among us today. We want to pray for them. They have given of their lives, they've given years, and perhaps sacrificed for the freedoms that we enjoy today. And we have several. Those that are veterans and have served in our country, would you please stand? Would you please stand? Amen. Brother Jerry, Brother Lou, Brother Charlie Kinsey, Brother Ed Siegler. We want to thank you on behalf of our church because of the time that you gave so that we can have these freedoms today. And we want to pray for you that God would bless you in a special way. And that you would feel his hand of blessing upon you. And let's pray. Lord, we ask your blessings upon these men that represent our church and that have given of their lives. Lord, enjoy the freedoms that we have right now. Bless them in a wonderful way. May they feel your presence. Guiding and protecting them and their families. Father, we ask in Jesus' precious name, amen. Amen. Thank you so much, gentlemen. I have several other things I'd like to bring to mind here, and it was brought to my attention. As you know, in the democracy that we enjoy, it doesn't everything turn out the way we want. But we have to remember this, and as I mentioned it also in prayer, we have to remember this. We are not Democrats or Republicans. We are Christians first. Amen. We are Christians. We belong to Christ. And Christ is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And no one is in power without God's permission. Amen. And so we need to pray for those that are in power over us. Of dislike. We don't need to put that into place right now. We need to put the Lord in his place. We need to pray for guidance and protection of the new administration that's coming in. And that God would have his way. Amen. We need to also pray for Panama and Honduras. This has been brought to my attention. Eta, this hurricane that seemed like just a disturbance, has turned into a terrible hurricane, Category 4, which has killed over 100 people, I was told, in Honduras. And there were other people, Inocencia brought to my attention, that were killed even in the province where she was raised. And so there's been much devastation and loss of lives. Inocencia got in contact with Melvin Romero, our missionary in Honduras. He was not able to contact her immediately, but he later contacted her. They are well. They and their immediate church are well. But people that are from their church down in San Pedro, they are in Tegucigalpa, I think it's called. Those that are south in San Pedro, they are not well at all. And there has been much loss of those people. We need to have this in mind. These are brothers and sisters in Christ. And they have lost everything. I saw some aerial views on the news of Honduras. And it was terrible. It was terrible, devastated. And so, even though we don't know all of the people involved, they are our brothers and sisters in Christ. And we need to pray for them. Amen? And so we're going to have a brief prayer for them in a moment. I'd also want to thank those that are visiting today. My wife just in Walmart this week. As everybody, how many go to Walmart? Everybody goes to Walmart. And lo and behold, I had my mask on. And this lady comes up with a young girl. She says, "Pastor!" I said, "The mask." And then she took the mask off, and I realized it was Edie's. Edie's, here she is over here. And she says, "Are you still pastoring over there in Templeton?" Oh, says, "Yes. Yes, we're still doing that. What time are the services?" And lo and behold, she's here with her family, her Amen. Whole family. And we're happy to have her. We're happy also to have Kathleen. Kathleen has been coming now for several services. And I just had an irking in my heart. I said, I don't remember having a card from Kathleen. And so I just, on a spur of a moment, took a card up. And I says, "Have you filled out one of these?" She said, "No, I haven't." I said, "Would you please fill that out?" He says, "We need to have a notation of your being here, and so that we can know you, and that we can be in contact." And so Kathleen has been here now for two or three weeks, and she and her daughter have been coming regularly, and they were invited by Rose. And they're good friends, and so we're so happy that Kathleen is here. God bless you. And we place ourselves with you. You know, in the midst of the pandemic, when we can have visitors, that's a good thing. That is a good thing. I have been praying, and I'm going to be very frank with you. I have been praying. I know that there are many people that cannot return. I talked to the Sanfords this last week up in Crystal River. She's having some special treatments with her lungs now. They wanted to give her chemotherapy. She said she opted out on that. And so the doctor said that they were going to have to give her some other special treatment. And so they're starting that. So her condition is very delicate. And we understand that it might be very, very difficult for them to return to church. And so, but in spite of that, we need to pray for them, pray for Joe and Evelyn Sanford. We love them dearly. And in spite of that, I know that some people, it's going to be difficult for them to come back because of their condition or because of their high risk. But Lord, send new people our way.
Amen.
And God is honoring that prayer. And I want you to join with me in that.
Amen.
That God will bring new people our way. That we can minister to. And we can be a blessing to. Blessing to other people. And I want our church to be a blessing to other people. And so we want that to happen. We have one other thing here. And I'm going to take a little time out of my preaching for this. Michael Lyle, he has been coming here for several years now, and he's here this morning. I see my friend Michael.
Good morning.
Michael is moving. He's going up this week?
I haven't decided yet if I was going to take a train or a plane. So.
Okay, but he's going to Buffalo, New York. Now, just the sound of that sends shrivels up and down my spine. That is a cold place. That's near Niagara Falls. And he's going there to live with his uncle and cousin. And he's going to work there. God has placed in his heart, God's opened this door, and he's going there. And he asked me, "Pastor, could I just have a couple minutes to tell the people how much I've appreciated being here in the church and how God has blessed me? Would you come, Michael, and give a testimony?"
Oh, boy. I just wanted just to say a few words. Just
very right
few words. I just want to let everybody know that Not only you are all in my prayers, but the Lord Jesus, my God, our God, that lives in me, loves all of you. Amen. Thank you for the courage, Pastor.
Amen. And Michael's come a long way. If you had seen Michael about how many years ago? 5 years ago? 5 years ago, you know, he was just disorientated totally. Mm-hmm. And we went out on a limb to help him in many ways. And I tried to help him and encourage him. And lo and behold, the Lord has solidified his faith. And he's seeking the Lord. He wants to serve the Lord. And Michael, this pastor loves you. And we just wish the best for you and whatever God would have for you. All right? And so right now, we're going to pray. We're going to pray for guidance for Michael. We're going to pray for Panama and Honduras and our brothers and sisters in Christ in those countries that are devastated. We're going to pray for our visitors today, that God would help you and guide you and lead you. And if this is the place that God would have you to be, may it be so clear. And I would love to. I really would. And so we want to pray for these things right now. We want to pray for our country. Our country is in a crossroads. And we need to pray for God's guidance, God's protection, and for the administration. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I seek you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. I seek your face. Lord, I pray that you will hear this plea from my heart. We're asking for various things today. We're asking, first of all, that we so love. We ask for guidance and protection and for the new administration. Lord, we ask for our brothers and sisters in Panama and in Honduras, devastated and that have lost loved ones during this terrible hurricane. We ask for our missionaries that are there, for Melvin Romero, and for, Lord, the families that serve there in representative of our church. Oh, Father, we ask for the visitors today, that you would guide them and protect them. And if this is the place we have them to be, may it be very clear in their hearts. Father, we ask for those that are ill, like Evelyn Sanford, and many others that are unable, especially the Pincuses, Jess and Penny Pincus. Father, we ask your blessings of Browder and his wife Carolyn, and Fred Venable and his wife that cares for him. And Lord, we for Glenn Talbot, who's in that rest home, and we're unable to visit him. Oh, Father, may your mercies be upon all of these petitions that we've lifted up to you. We ask it in the powerful and wonderful name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen, and amen. Amen. I'd invite you to open your Bibles with me, please, to John chapter 12. If you are reading through the Bible, we are approximately right there in John chapter 12 as we read through the Bible in 1 year. And hopefully, many of you are still doing that. We're going to read John chapter 12, verses 1 through 8. John chapter 12, verses 1 through 8. I would ask you, if you can and are able, would you stand with me in the reading of God's Word? Then Jesus, 6 days after Passover, came to Bethany, where Lazarus was, which had been dead. There they and Martha served, and that at the table with him. Then took Mary a pound and anointed Jesus, and wiped his feet with her hair, and the house was with the odor of the ointment. May we put our lives in the balance of the Word of God. Lord, may we seek your face as never before. Bless our church. Lord, we cannot go forth without your blessings. May souls be touched. May people be saved because of the pronouncement of your holy word. And we ask this all in Jesus' precious name. Amen,
amen
and amen. Thank you so much. You can be seated. In chapter 11 of John, it records that Jesus had just done one of his greatest miracles, the raising of Lazarus from the dead. And he had pronounced also some of his greatest words. And in fact, I'd like you to look at those words with me in John chapter 11. John chapter 11, verse 25 through 27. Jesus had just pronounced one of his greatest words. He said, Jesus saith unto her, unto Martha, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. Believest thou this? And she saith unto him, Yea, Lord, I believe that thou art the Christ, the Son of God, which... And so we find here the stage where it's been set. Jesus is in Bethany. He's just there a few days before going into Jerusalem for the last time in his life. And he's there now in Lazarus' house after he's raised him from the dead. And he's having a banquet with Lazarus. They had prepared a meal, a banquet in honor of Jesus. Martha, Mary, Lazarus, and his friends, because of the great joy, Lazarus was alive. And so they were celebrating Jesus. Look at chapter 12. Look at chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. Then Jesus, 6 days before the Passover, came to Bethany, where Lazarus was, which had been dead, and he was raised from the dead. There they made him a supper, and and Lazarus was one of them that sat at the table with him. I can imagine Lazarus. I can imagine that the time that he came out of that tomb, he had a smile on his face. Amen. But I would have been tickled. Amen. I would have been tickled to death. Now, in spite of this, all of this festivity that's going on, the Pharisees are seeking to put Jesus and Lazarus to death. All of the festivities of joy and of praising God because he is the giver of life. And in the backgrounds, the Pharisees are scheming to entrap Jesus and to kill him. Not only to kill Jesus now, but they wanted to kill Lazarus. I don't know, he's already been dead, he's going to get killed again. Ever thought of that? Look at chapter 11. I'd like to bring your attention back to chapter 11 and verse 53. Then from that day forth, they took counsel together for to put him to death. These are the Pharisees. Look at verse 56 and 57. Then sought they for Jesus as they stood in the temple. What think ye, that he will not come to the feast? Now both the chief priest and the Pharisees had been given a commandment that if any man knew where he were, they should show it that they might take him. So notice what's going on. Jesus was going to go into Jerusalem. He had no going into Jerusalem. As he goes into Jerusalem for the last time, notice in verse 55 in chapter 11. And the Jews' Passover was nigh at hand, it was very near. And many went out from the country up to Jerusalem before the Passover to purify themselves. This was the greatest feast, and is still the greatest feast of the Jews today, the Passover. And everyone was always going to Jerusalem, the city of God. And this time around, Jesus was going to Jerusalem to be to the Passover. But in this case, he knew that he was going to be the Passover lamb. He was going to be the Passover lamb. And Jesus, he was his feet with a very expensive perfume. There's been songs written about this. There have been poems written about it. But we don't really get the essence. And I pray that you would look at the Word of God and ask God to show you something here today. Look at chapter 12 and verse 3. Then took Mary. Now Mary was the one that worshipped, was always listening to Jesus' words. Remember Martha? Martha was always busybody, cleaning the house. Servant. But I think it's best to be a worshiper. Amen? We need those two things in our lives. We need to be servants, but we need to worship the Lord. And Mary, it says in verse 3, then took Mary a pound of ointment of spikenard. Now I looked that up, spikenard. That to us doesn't mean anything. But I looked it up. The perfume of spikenard was a fragrant ointment imported from the mountains of India. Very expensive. The amount that Mary used was equal to a year's wages. A year's wages. That's what it was. She was pouring this out on Jesus' feet. And you say, how did she pour that out on Jesus' feet? I'm glad she asked. The tables back then were not like the tables we have today. We have tables where we sit underneath the table. And usually in back in my time, I said, how did she get there? Did she crawl under the table? No. You see, the tables were probably maybe 6 to 8 inches tall. They were small tables, just like they are if you go into the Mideast, and people would lean on their elbows. And this is how they ate, and their feet were outward. They were sort of leaning. And so now you can see how Mary got to Jesus' feet easily. His feet were out. Now, normally, the custom in the Mideastern places, and even in Jerusalem, and there was a servant given charge to everyone that came into house to wash the feet of people because they used sandals. And their feet got very dirty with the sand and the dirt. And so when they came in, they would take their shoes off, and still in Asian countries, they still take their shoes off at the door. They place them at the door, and here the servant would wash the feet and dry the feet of the people. But then Jesus was at the table, at the supper. His sandals were not on his feet. They had been taken off, remember? Placed probably near the door with everyone else. And his feet were already washed. But something extra happens. Mary takes a pound of ointment of spikenard, this special, expensive fragrance imported from the mountains of India. Very costly. And anointed the feet of Jesus. Now, I learned also that this fragrance, this spikenard, was used to anoint kings. I didn't know that. This was a fragrance used to anoint kings. And the people pay large amounts preparing for their day of death. So that in the tomb, they would use this to nullify the putrefaction of the body. And so this spikenard, she had saved up a lot of money, very costly. But here she is, anointing the feet of Jesus. And notice this, and she wiped his feet with her hair. She probably had very long hair, probably came down to maybe her waist. And she dried his feet with her hair. This is a sign of worship. She's worshiping Jesus. And notice this, and the house was filled with the odor of the ointment. Mary was anointing Jesus as her king and her Messiah in front of everyone. And it was very, very noticeable. Amen? And then all of a sudden, we have another person that comes into the act. Judas Iscariot. Notice verse 4 and 5. Then saith one of his disciples, Judas Iscariot. Now, who was Judas Iscariot? It says it right there. Simon's son, which should betray him. The 12th disciple. He was going to sell Jesus later on for 30 pieces of silver. He was interested in Mula. From the next phrases, it says, now the mula doesn't say that in the Bible. And it says here, he says, why was not this ointment sold for 300 pence? Now you say, 300 pence, what does that mean? Well, 1 pence, Peter brought this out recently. 1 pence was 1 denarius. If we look into what 1 denarius was, it was 1 day of a labor of a person. What you would earn for a whole day, one denarius. But he says, this ointment could have been sold for 300 pence. Now that's almost a year's wages. This is what she did, 300 denarius. And why wasn't it given it to the poor? Boy, he was very pious. Did you know that there's a lot of pious people in church that maybe don't even know Jesus? This is an example, right? And notice what it says. Then this he said, not that before, he was putting up a front, but because he was a thief and had the bag, he was the treasure of the 12 apostles. And bear what was put therein. He skimmed off of the bag. He was a skimmer. Hey, there were people that did terrible things even in that day, and they do it today also, right? And notice what it says here. Jesus speaks up, verse 7 and 8. Then said Jesus, "Let her alone. Against the day of my bearing has she kept this." Jesus is giving them hints. I'm going to die. And she is preparing me for my death. Amen? And in verse 8 it says, "For always ye have with you, but me ye have not always." Again referring that he was going to leave them. So Jesus knew the heart and mind of Lazarus. And I want to tell you today, Jesus knows who you are. Jesus knows if you're brought here because somebody brought you and you didn't come on your own intent. Jesus knows if you came here to for the good of what people think. I don't know about you, but I come to worship the Lord because I love Him. Amen. Jesus knows if you really love Him or not. Jesus knows the intent of your heart. Jesus knows your attitude right now. Do you truly belong to Him? You know, I would dare say, and I don't want to be judgmental, but even in this many people, there might be someone here that still you've heard of Jesus for all your life, for many years, and you still have not put your trust totally in the Lord Jesus Christ. And God knows you. God knows who you are. Just like God knew Judas. Now notice here, in verse 9 through 11, the response of the people that were around Lazarus' house. "Much people of the Jews, therefore, knew that he was there. And they came not for Jesus' sake only, but that they might see Lazarus also, whom he had." There were no newspapers back in those days, but you know what? Just like today, people like to talk. Amen? And the news gets out. And they say, "Lazarus, the man that died, he's alive. And he's eating with Jesus in his house. Really? We need to see this." And so people would come from the aligning villages and homes, and they were all around the house where Jesus was. And there were a multitude of people. And they came not only to see Jesus, but they came to see Lazarus. Notice what it says here also in verse 10. "But the chief priest," not only did the people come, but hey, the weasels were there too. Say, weasels? Yeah. You know what weasels are, right? They're not the best of animals, right? And they sort of sort of get into the chicken coops and steal the eggs and do all kinds of things, if you ever lived in a country, all right? And so the weasels were there, but the chief priests consulted that they might put Lazarus also to death. So now, blacklist. Notice it says, "But that for reason of him, many of the Jews went away and believed on Jesus." He said, "We got to get rid of this guy. Because of him, people are following Jesus now." People are following Jesus. Now, the next day after this Supper is what we call today Palm Sunday. So this must have occurred on a Saturday. I was thinking about trying to get it in my mind, when did this supper occur? Saturday? Maybe. And here it is today. Notice what it says here. And verse 12. For the next day, when people would come to the feast, when they heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem. So we know that we celebrate the fact that Jesus came into Jerusalem Sunday, the first day of the week. Jerusalem. And so Jesus is entering Jerusalem for the last time in his earthly ministry. But he enters not on a steed. You know what a steed is? That's not a word that we use in our daily vernacular. But I'm trying to get all these words that they use in the King James and so forth so we can understand. On a magnificent horse. He did not come riding on a magnificent horse. He didn't come on a steed. But he came, and it says here, and as we continue reading, Jesus comes into Jerusalem and he seeks a donkey. He sits on a donkey. I remember years past, we took the young people to the church, of the church, over to ride horses in the horse stables out in Valrico. There's some horse stables there. And everybody was picking out their horses and so forth. And there were no more horses. He says, well, Pastor, what are you going to ride? He says, and the owner said, well, we have a mule here. He says, is that all right? I said, I guess so. Mm-hmm. And so I rode on a mule. It wasn't as magnificent as riding on a horse. But I rode on a mule. And Jesus did not enter on a steed. He came in on a donkey. That's sort of humbling, don't you think? Notice what it says here in verse 12 and following. On the next day, which people that were come to the feast or the Passover, when they heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem, took branches of palm trees and went forth to meet him and cried, Hosanna, Hosanna, blessed is the King of Israel that cometh in the name of the Lord. And Jesus, when he had found a young ass, sat upon, as it is written, Fear not, daughter of Zion, behold, thy king cometh, sitting on an ass's colt. And these things understood not his disciples at the first. But when Jesus was glorified, then remembered they that these things were written of him, and that they had done these things unto him. See, everything that Jesus did, he did fulfilling the scriptures. You see, Jesus did not come to the Jews as a general or a political leader. He came as the Prince of Peace. Amen? The Prince of Peace. He came to Jerusalem not to deliver them from the Roman oppressors. He came to give them life and rest for their souls. This is what Jesus came. Jesus enters Jerusalem for the last time before his death, fulfilling prophecies as it is mentioned in Isaiah 9, 6. He is the Prince of Peace. And Zechariah 9. In fact, I have it right here. You don't have to look for it. I'll read it. And Zechariah 9, 9. It says here, Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, O daughter of Jerusalem, behold, thy king cometh unto thee. He is just and having salvation, lowly, and riding upon an ass, and upon a colt, the foal of an ass. So Jesus, everything that he did was to fulfill the prophecies of the prophets to the T. Because he is, was, and ever will be the Messiah, the promised Savior, the only one in which we have salvation for our souls. Amen? Now Jesus, as he enters into Jerusalem, he is confronted with some people that were not from Jerusalem. They were Greeks. Sometimes people, as we read through the Bible, they don't remember this. And here we find in chapter 12 and verse 20. Verse 20 through 22. And there were certain Greeks among them that came up to worship in the feast. Now, if they came to worship in the feast, they had to be Greeks that had converted to Judaism. They were Jews, and so another country and culture, but they came to worship in Jerusalem, the Passover. And it says here, these same people, the Greeks, verse 21, came therefore to Philip, beside Bethsaida of Galilee, saying, "Sir, we would see Jesus." They knew that Philip was one of the apostles. And so they came to him and he says, "We'd like to see Jesus. We'd like to talk to him personally." And so Philip, verse 22, cometh and telleth Andrew. And again Andrew and Philip, they told Jesus. And Jesus answered them saying, and Jesus speaks to them. He takes them apart after entering Jerusalem. One of the first conversations, and Jesus reveals to these people his divine purpose. Listen to this. As I was meditating on this, remember when Jesus was at the well of Samaria? He revealed himself not to a Jew, a full-blooded Jew. He revealed himself to a Samaritan woman. And not only a Samaritan woman, but a woman that was indecent. She had had five husbands. And the one that she was living with was not her husband. And Jesus revealed himself to her before anyone else. Jesus reveals himself now going into his very first conversation with anyone is with Greeks. They're not full-blooded Jews. What does this tell you and tell me? That the message of Jesus is for everyone in the world. Praise the Lord. Salvation is for you. And even for me. A half Puerto Rican, half North American. And Jesus, no matter what your ethnicity is, God loves you and wants you to be saved. And it says here, Jesus reveals his purpose in verse 23 and following. And Jesus answered them saying, "The hour is come that the Son of Man should be glorified. Verily, verily, I say unto you, except a corn of wheat fall into the ground and die, it abideth, it bringeth forth much fruit. He that loveth his life shall lose it, and he that hateth his life in this world shall keep it unto life eternal. If any man serve me, let him follow me, and if where my servant be, if any man serve me, him will my Father honor. Now is my soul troubled, And what shall I say? And Jesus brings out his humanity here. Father, save me from this hour. Humanly speaking, he was depressed. Humanly speaking, he felt anxiety. And then he says here, but for this cause came I into this hour. He knew that he was there to die for the sins of humanity. And he says, for this cause I came. And then he says in verse 28, look at what he says, Father, glorify thy name. He says this openly. You know what happens then? Look at this. A miracle happens. Then came there a voice from heaven saying, I have both glorified it, and I will glorify it again. And the people thereof that stood by and heard it said it thundered. Others said, an angel spake unto him. Jesus answered and said, this voice, it wasn't thunder, it wasn't an angel, it was the voice of God. This voice came not because of me, but for your sakes. Now it is the judgment of this world. Now shall the prince of this world be cast out. Who's the prince of this world? Satan himself. That's why the world's the way it is right now. And it's getting worse. Satan is the prince of this world. But Jesus destroyed his power on the cross of Calvary. His head was crushed. And whosoever believeth in Christ, we shall have victory. We can have life in abundance in spite of the circumstances in the Lord Jesus Christ. That's why I say it's not necessarily who is president. The fact is, Jesus is still on the throne. And he's King of Kings. And he is the Prince of Peace. And he's Lord of Lords. And he's mine. And I belong to him. Do you belong to him right now? Can you say rightfully in your heart, Christ is on the throne of my heart? Have you received him as your Lord and Savior? If you have doubts of that, would you pray with us today and accept him? Give him your life. He wants to be your Lord and your personal Savior. He wants to guide you. He wants to lead you. He wants you to have peace in the midst of the turbulence. Amen? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this wonderful narrative of the Lord Jesus Christ as he enters Jerusalem. And even prior, the day prior, as Mary anointed his feet with this priceless and expensive ointment, worshiping him, that he is King. I pray that Jesus is our Lord and King as we listen to this message. And if not, Lord, may we render ourselves totally to you. Father, and as Jesus directed the words to these Greeks that were not Jewish in blood, but perhaps converted Jews, Lord, Jesus revealed his purpose that he came to die for life eternal, for whoever would believe in him. And I'm so glad, Lord, that you paid the price of my eternal salvation and for all that would truly believe in you. Lord, I'm so thankful that you're my personal Lord and Savior. And I pray that someone at the sound of my voice would render their heart and life to you. And I ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. And you that are watching, has God touched you? Has God spoken to you in his word today? Is he your Lord and Savior? You know, there are many Judas Iscariots in churches today, false followers. I hope you're not one of those. I pray that you would be like Mary, a true worshiper of the Lord. And if not, would you give your heart over to him right now? Would you pray with me? Lord Jesus, you, my life is empty. My life has I have lack of direction, and I need you right now. I let you sit on the throne of my heart. Lord, be my Lord and Savior from this moment on. I ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. What a wonderful narrative, amen? What a wonderful narrative. If you made a decision in your heart, we'd love to hear about it. Would you call us and let us know? You can call us at 813-985-5292. We are the Temple Heights Baptist Church. We're located at 5020 Puritan Road, Tampa, Florida, 33617. If you have any questions about what we believe or our church, you can call us at our office from Monday through Friday from 9 to 2. And our secretary will give you information. If you would like to contribute to the ongoing cost of our ministry as we continually open up more and more, and we have people coming now that are visiting, and we pray that God will just touch their hearts to be a part of our church. If you would like to contribute to the expansion of the ministry, both here in Tampa and around the world, you can send your tithes and offerings to Temple Heights Baptist Church, P.O. Box 290392, Tampa, Florida, 33687. We've started our Sunday school now. We're in our third week at 9:30 in the morning. We have the service at 10:30. We have opened up our Bible Institute on Tuesday at 6:00, and we're studying the life of Christ in the Gospel of John. Midweek service and Bible study for the adults, and for the children and young people, we have the Bible Club Awana. It's in process, and we want the young people to learn the Word of God, hiding the Word of God in their hearts that they might not sin against Him. Amen. And will you come and be a part of it? We pray for every petition that is made on Wednesday, personally. We're so thankful that you are with us this morning. What a great group of people. Next week, we have the Lord's Supper. We're going to have that at the 10:30 hour. And if you want to take part personally in the Lord's Supper, we will have it at 10:30. Come and be a part of it. And we're so thankful that you tuned in and that you are here. What a good group of people today. God bless each and every one. You be blessed. You stay safe. You be victorious in the Lord Jesus Christ. I'm so glad.